Introduce the chair of our board, and at this time we will have remarks from Mr. David Baldwin.
Good evening, Baylor College of Medicine graduates, families, and friends. I am David Baldwin, chair of the Board of Trustees of Baylor College of Medicine, and it is my distinct pleasure to welcome you to the 2020 virtual graduation ceremony. I wish that we were holding this very special event in Jones Hall, but as newly minted healthcare and research professionals, you and your families recognize that this is the safest way to celebrate your incredible achievements. Over the last 2 months, the board has carefully followed all of the activities at Baylor. We have been so impressed with the innovation that we have seen from the faculty, staff, and students to address this pandemic in particular. We have also been inspired by the volunteer activities that the students have undertaken to address the very basic needs of those in the Houston community, as well as in the Texas Medical Center. You have shown what servant leadership is all about, and I am confident that each of you will take these skills and apply them in your new positions. On behalf of the entire board, congratulations on becoming alumni of one of the best medical schools in the country. We know that you will make all of us very proud as you begin this next phase of your professional careers. Congratulations and welcome.
Baldwin. Baylor's premier educational programs involve the efforts of many important people. We would like to express our great appreciation and our thanks to our Chancellor, Dr. Bert O'Malley, the department chairs, center directors, for all of their leadership and their many contributions. Our students are supported throughout their training by the outstanding work of our deans, associate deans, assistant deans, and program directors in our four schools. I know that you will join me in thanking them. These leaders, along with the Baylor faculty, administration, alumni, and staff, all play vital roles in Baylor's educational mission. Please join me in thanking them for the investment and support of our students. Finally, I want to thank the leaders of Baylor's 8 affiliated teaching hospitals for the essential contributions that each and every one makes to ensure that our students have exceptional clinical training opportunities. Their partnership and support of mission and of our students is vital to our outstanding educational programs. It is now my pleasure and distinct honor to introduce Dr. Paul Klotman. Dr. Klotman is the CEO, President, and Executive Dean at Baylor College of Medicine. He has served in this role of president since the fall of 2010. Under his leadership, Baylor has grown in prominence in education, research, and patient care. He believes that the greatest asset of any organization is its people. And Baylor is an institution filled with outstanding people working together for success. Throughout his career, Dr. Klotman has been a strong advocate for students and recognizes the important role that trainees have played in all of the missions at Baylor. He has great passion for excellence and teamwork. He is a visionary leader who understands the importance of academic medicine in our society, particularly at a time like this. Will you please join me in welcoming Dr. Paul Klotman?
Yeah, it's unfortunate we're doing this virtually because normally there's a thunder of applause in Jones Hall, and we usually have to employ crowd control and a number of other things to keep people off the stage, but it is what it is. So I welcome you all virtually. I want to thank Dr. Monroe. Also want to recognize the families and friends of our students. Your support is absolutely vital over the last few months in helping them reach this day. Graduates, this year many of you have your family and friends beside you, and I hope you take a moment to join me in thanking them. My family is also online, and my dog Lily is here also apparently on the stage. In addition to the degrees I will confer upon you tonight, we'll also present honorary degrees and leadership awards to outstanding individuals who have each created a legacy of excellence. These honorees were selected to serve as role models for the kind of leaders we were prepared you to become. Each has made remarkable contributions that have made an impact on education, research, patient care, and outreach initiatives in their communities. I encourage each of you to envision what you can accomplish in your career and your goals with the same passion as tonight's awardees. And three of our awardees, John DeMonte, Dr. Peter Durvin, and Grace Schumain, are joining us remotely tonight and will be at the 2021 graduation to be honored in person, assuming we have one. We can only hope. The Doctor of Humanities in Medicine is being awarded to Mr. John DeMonte, the President of the Bristol-Myers Squibb Foundation and Vice President of Corporate Philanthropy and Patient Assistance. Through his leadership, Bristol-Myers Squibb has provided over $100 million of support to the Baylor Pediatric AIDS Initiative at Texas Children's Hospital during the last 20 years. The support from Bristol-Myers Squibb and John DeMonte have helped BPI provide HIV/AIDS treatment to over 300,000 children and their families, more than any organization worldwide. So upon the recommendation of the faculty and by the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees of Baylor College of Medicine, I confer upon John Tamonte the honorary degree of Doctor of Humanities in Medicine and admit you to all its rights, responsibilities, and privileges. Congratulations, John. I hope to see you next year live. The Doctor of Letters in Medicine is being awarded to Peter Durvin, Professor of Chemistry at the California Institute of Technology and Chair of the Scientific Advisory Board of the Welch Foundation. His research in the development and study of small organic molecules using sequence-specific recognition of DNA has been internationally recognized. He is credited with influencing the course of research in organic chemistry through his studies at the interface of chemistry and biology. He's a member of the National Academy of Sciences and was named one of 8 recipients of the 2006 National Medal of Science. Lily. I would like to point out that his wife, Jackie Barton, also received an honorary degree from Baylor College of Medicine in 2012, and they are the first husband-wife team to do so. Really happy for both of you. Congratulations. Upon the recommendation of the faculty and by the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees of Baylor College of Medicine, I confer upon Peter Durvin the honorary degree of Doctor of Letters in Medicine and admit you to all its rights, responsibilities, and privileges. Congratulations, Peter, and again, hope to see you live next year. We have 3 distinguished leadership awards to present tonight, recognizing individuals and organizations who have provided exceptional service to society or have a history of doing work that has been a major benefit in the field of health. The first award is being presented to Grace Schumann, president of the Texas League of Women Voters. Ms. Schumann is a retired pediatric nurse practitioner who joined the League in 2012. She focuses on the use of technology to reach and support voters. The Texas League of Women Voters provides nonpartisan information on candidates and proposed amendments to educate voters about issues prior to elections. The organization has partnered with Baylor to assist our faculty, staff, and trainees with voter registration, as well as information related to local, state, and national elections. And it is my pleasure to present the Distinguished Leadership Award to Grace Schumann and the Texas League of Women Voters. I'm sorry you couldn't be here with us live. The COVID-19 pandemic led the Texas Medical Center CEOs to work together in ways never imagined to assure that we were prepared to care for those in our community who became infected. As a result of their outstanding leadership during this pandemic, we are honoring 2 individuals for this effort. Mr. Bill McKeon is president and CEO of the Texas Medical Center. When it became clear that the pandemic would impact Houston, he brought the TMC CEOs together for daily meetings for the last 2 months. Through his leadership, each day, we know the number of positive cases, the number of patients and ICU patients, and how much protective clothing each organization has on hand. Bill has built a consensus in the TMC by providing data and facts. I believe his efforts are one of the reasons the Houston community, has done so well, and I'll say so well so far, hoping for the best. But it is my honor to present the Baylor Distinguished Leadership Award to Bill McKeon for his work in leading the TMC response to the COVID-19 pandemic. And Bill, come on up and say a few words.
Thank you, Dr. Kloutman. To the faculty, to the board, and particularly to the class of 2020, I know these are unusual times, and unusual times really require us to do unusual things. When we saw the breakout of the virus in Wuhan, it was interesting that all of us pulled together very quickly. We didn't wait until this virus moved around the world. We understood its danger. We pulled everyone together, and it's amazing. This award really is an award about all of the CEOs. Dr. Kloutman played a formidable role, Dr. Jim McDevitt, and you're going to hear from Dr. Porson in a minute, but all the CEOs pulled together in a way never before seen in our 75-year history. I should also mention the class of 2020. This is our 75-year history, and Baylor College of Medicine was the single first institution in the Texas Medical Center's storied career. What is interesting about what took place after we pulled together is we didn't just formalize together as CEOs, we formed a committee around policy, around ethics, around supply chain, And we pulled all those forces together. We actually activated our views towards our civic leaders when we saw the danger of major events going on in our city, and we pulled together and we influenced the decisions and the bold decisions of our civic leaders to come together and make the tough decisions to really stay down. And I think that we've seen the numbers. We were moving the virus was moving through our community on the same level of trajectory of Italy and New York City. And because of the great efforts of our governor, our civic leaders, the medical center, we were able to stay off that growth, that exponential growth. We're not out of it. As Dr. Kloppman said, this is a war that's going to continue for a very long period of time. But it was an honor to be sitting really at a convening role to all of these great leaders and all the great work that has been done here. For the class, I just want to take 1 minute to say the blessing that we have in my storied career in healthcare has been forever. And I know I'm going to show some numbers. This is not a handkerchief. It's actually some data. I wanted to share one thing, that for those healthcare leaders that are caring for patients, you will see 1,600 patients a year in your career, every year. Take that over 30 years, you're going to see 48,000 people, one individual, one physician providing care, 48,000. And I want to remind you all this special thing. I've had the privilege to lead companies around the world. One thing that's eternally true is you are the light. You are the special light in every person's eyes about when they walk through that door. And the privilege that you have, whether you're an administrator or you're conducting breaking research, carry that with you, because this class alone, I've done the numbers, you will affect 13,248,000 people, this class alone, in your careers, your storied careers to come. So I hope you keep that gift with you. I hope you never lose sight of it. You might be seeing the 20th patient a day, or you might be walking into a lab and thinking you're facing formidable odds of changing ALS or other things. And I just hope that you keep that spirit in you, that you are that beacon for so many people that every day walk in to a clinic or walk into a clinical trial, and they have hope and they're betting on all of the great work that this faculty and your students have led to. And you remember 13 million people that this class alone at Baylor College of Medicine can affect. So congratulations to the class, and I hope you live a wonderful career and will touch many of these 13 million lives. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Bill. Dr. Esmail Porsa is the president and CEO of the Harris Health System and the newest CEO in the TMC, arriving just as cases of COVID-19 were being seen in our area. Probably the worst timing in history for any new job. But he brings 20 years of experience in providing health care within jail facilities in Texas and in caring for the underserved, just at a time when we needed that perspective the most. He cares about the most vulnerable patients who are traditionally at risk for disease, particularly during a pandemic. And Dr. Porsa has been a tireless advocate for these communities. His insight into care of these at-risk populations has really been essential in our developing a variety of contingency plans to assure that all members of our community are cared for. And it is my pleasure to present the Baylor Distinguished Leadership Award to Esmail Porsa for his work in responding to the pandemic. Esmail?
I'll be brief.
You can take off your mask.
Thank you. What a pleasure not to have to wear a mask. Good evening, everyone, and congratulations again. Thank you, Dr. Kloppman, Baylor College of Medicine, for this award. I'm honored and humbled to receive this recognition. To the graduating class of Baylor College of Medicine, class of 2020, congratulations. Please accept my most sincere congratulations. The profession of medicine and the art of healing bodies and minds has never before been referred to as noble as it is today. Terms like frontline, essential, superheroes are being used to refer to you, and very suitably so. As you take your next steps in your professional life and you step into the floors of hospitals and clinics across our country, I want you to feel confident and take pride of the fact that you have been trained by one of the most premier institutions of higher learning and one of the best medical schools in the world. Harris Health System is also proud to have taken a part in your training. You are indeed ready. Tonight is about you and about your achievements. So I just want to wish you good luck, good health, and great careers. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Porcer. I think we've been really lucky to have the leadership we've had to get through the early stages of this pandemic. Members of the class of 2020 and your families, congratulations. What a tremendous accomplishment. When you entered the Baylor College of Medicine, you had no idea that you would live through one hurricane and a global pandemic. If you ever wondered about your career choice before, I hope that these challenges have given you clarity, focus, and a sense of purpose that few graduating classes before you would have. Because of these challenges that you have faced, you may not realize it now, but you have a real chance to inspire others in the future. When I graduated from medical school, the people who inspired me were legends whose careers had shaped the practice of medicine. DeBakey, Stead, Sabiston, Brownwald. At the time I graduated, they all seemed so distant to me, like they were in another world, another time, far ahead of me. Never seemed like I could ever do anything like them. But crises bring out inspiration that is much more tangible, much more present. I personally have been through many. The early years of the HIV pandemic, 9/11 in New York, two floods, one hurricane, two hospital fires, H1N1, two flu pandemics, SARS, MERS, Ebola, and now COVID-19. And in each one, I was amazed that someone, some individual inspired me. Someone just like you, not those legends that I had admired in the past. And each one of you has it within you to be inspirational. So how can you inspire so early in your careers? What does it take to inspire others? Well, early in the HIV pandemic, no one knew how the virus was transmitted. It's hard to believe now, but hemophiliac kids who got HIV from their infusions were often ostracized. People were afraid to touch children because they were afraid they might get infected with HIV. Even though we knew that was not the mode of transmission. I saw a group of pediatric interns hesitant to even walk into a room with an HIV-positive kid. It was incredibly awkward. And then one of the interns, a young woman, did not hesitate, entered the room and walked up to the kid and gave him a great big hug. Sometimes to inspire others, you just have to walk into a room when no one else will. On the morning of 9/11, we already had word the planes had hit the Twin Towers, all our air traffic was grounded, and we had no idea if there would be more attacks on the city. Many of my colleagues left our high-rise building out of understandable fear. But the disaster medical team that had prepared for events like this, all ran to the emergency room, got their orders, and prepared for the onslaught of trauma victims that were sure to come pouring in. No one came, but that team was ready, most not knowing where their family members were or even if they were safe. And in my mind, they were all heroes. And sometimes to inspire others, you just have to show up, even if no one comes. We had a terrible hospital fire at Mount Sinai in New York. A room that fed the main air duct for the hospital had an electrical fire and smoke poured into the ventilation system throughout the hospital. After 9/11, firefighters were not allowed to go into a high-rise until the source of the fire was located, and since all rooms filled up with smoke at the same time, we couldn't locate the source of the fire. So medical residents, instead of firefighters, ran up the stairs and started evacuating 900 patients. To make sure all the patients were evacuated, the hospital president and I went up opposite stairwells, floor by floor, to make sure all the floors were empty. On the very top floor, I opened the fire door, and the smoke was so thick I could barely see the hand in front of me. And I called out to make sure no one was there. And a first-year resident emerged from the smoke, pushing the last patient to the stairwell and to safety on the only thing he could find, an office chair with wheels. Sometimes to inspire others, you have to make do with what you have, even if it's just an office chair. After Hurricane Harvey, Baylor students, including your class, wanted to help but weren't qualified yet to provide medical assistance. One of our students organized the others from all the Baylor schools into work teams and found faculty members who needed help at their flooded homes. Students went to faculty homes and packed clothes, ripped out carpets, cleaned up whatever the mess was. You students allowed distracted faculty members to return to work so they could provide care to patients or perform important experiments in their labs. The impact that you and other students had on these people was truly amazing. Sometimes to inspire others, cleaning out a garage is more important than putting on your white coat. This year, we've been overwhelmed by a coronavirus pandemic with no previous immunity has run through communities across the globe. It scares everyone while we wait for researchers to find effective treatments. It is exhausting and dangerous work. But every day at 7 p.m. across the country, many people go outside and applaud the nurses, doctors, and healthcare workers risking their lives to care for patients. Sometimes to inspire others, you just have to go to work and do your job because people need you. I hope you understand that these individual acts by physicians and students just like you inspire people everywhere and people like me to be a better person, a better doctor, and a more thoughtful member of the broader community. Because of your experiences here at Baylor, and especially during these crises, I believe each of you can inspire others to greatness in ways that others might not be able to. It doesn't take a career of excellence, and you don't need to be the most knowledgeable person to inspire others. All it takes is one act of courage, one act of inspiration. I want each of you to spend the rest of your careers recognizing those moments and being ready to stand up and be that person when it counts. And I know all of you can do that. Congratulations, class of 2020. I am so, so very proud of you.
Thank you, Dr. Klotman. It is now my pleasure to invite Hannah Lee Helber, president of the School of Health Professions Genetic Counseling class, to offer remarks on behalf of the inaugural class of genetics counseling graduates.
Thank you, Dr. Monroe. First, I would like to congratulate all graduating students on this monumental accomplishment. It is truly incredible to be graduating from such a wonderful institution and to feel the support of faculty, mentors, family, and our fellow students as we move into the real world. Thank you to everyone for being here today and supporting us students over the last few years. I am especially proud to represent the first class of genetic counselors to graduate from Baylor College of Medicine's genetic counseling program. My classmates and I had no idea what we were getting ourselves into with joining the inaugural class in BCM's genetic counseling program, and I can say with absolute certainty that our shared experiences over the past 2 years have prepared us to face the future. We were welcomed to BCM with open arms and by faculty just as eager to learn and grow with us. We made friends and shared classrooms with students across all of the schools here. And we were mentored every step of the way by clinical supervisors, thesis chairs, and course directors. This is especially true of Dan and Salma, our program leadership, as we would frequently randomly drop into their office, and we were never once turned away. Thank you for supporting and lifting us up over the past 2 years. The most rewarding aspect of this adventure in the inaugural class is the bond between classmates and walking away with lifelong friendships. Through this journey, I recognize shared traits amongst my classmates, and I believe that these extend across all of the trainees at BCM. There's a high level of resiliency, as evidenced by the fact that everyone here today is successfully graduating in spite of the unprecedented and uncertain times. Not only do the trainees at BCM know how to adapt, but we also know how to thrive no matter what. I urge everyone to remember this and that they too have shown adaptability and this ability to thrive as we head out into our next opportunities. This community has come together time and time again across all schools to support one another, and especially now. BCM fostered a compassionate environment, and that I know that we will all continue with our colleagues and into our next opportunities. The class of 2020 is caring, resilient, and above all else, committed to serving others. I am grateful to have learned beside you all and to call you all colleagues. Thank you and congratulations to the class of 2020.
Thank you very much for your remarks, Ms. Helber. At this time, I'd like to welcome to the podium Dr. Robert McLaughlin, Dean of the School of Health Professions, who will present the candidates for the degree of Master of Science.
Thank you. Dr. Klotman and Dr. Monroe, I have the high honor and privilege of presenting to you the 8 candidates for the degree of Master of Science. They have satisfactorily completed all the requirements for the degree. On behalf of the faculty of the School of Health Professions, I am pleased to recommend that you confer upon each candidate the degree of Master of Science and admit them to all its rights, responsibilities, and privileges.
Upon the recommendation of the faculty and by the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees of Baylor College of Medicine, I confer upon you the degree Master of Science and admit you to all its rights, responsibilities, and privileges.
We now have the opportunity to hear from Dr. Alexandra Lee Chang Graham, representing the Graduate School of Biomedical Sciences, to offer remarks on behalf of tonight's PhD graduates.
To state the obvious, this is not how I imagined I would be giving this address today. This is not how you pictured your graduation would be either. However, is having some unexpected change in plan really so surprising for a PhD student? We've all experienced the frustration and distress of setbacks, whether it was cell culture contamination, or a program crashing in the middle of data analysis, or yet another Western blot with smears instead of bands. After months of hard work, we have faced the reality of failed experiments and ambiguous results. Maybe you've had the setback of switching labs, or as in my case, drastically changing your thesis project. But no matter the challenge, you have all faced them, adapted, and developed the personal fortitude needed to meet each trial. The skills and strategies that we have honed to overcome failures and turn them into successes are the basis of the PhD conferred upon us today. In many ways, this graduation ceremony is an embodiment of this idea. Over this medium, our hoodings are imagined, and our diplomas are incorporeal. When we sign off today, we are not physically bringing anything with us as we leave as official doctoral graduates. This is appropriate because the quote unquote real PhD does not lie in our carefully printed theses and diplomas, but in the skills and experiences that we gained along the way. While we worried about the next experiment or thesis committee meeting, we were learning discipline, perseverance, and resilience. As we worked on papers and presentations, we were learning to think critically and communicate clearly as we grew as members and leaders of teams. We also learned to ask others for help, Whether guidance from mentors and collaborators or personal support from friends and family, we were learning the strength of community. And in turn, we learned to be better lab mates, friends, and family members. Our experiences in graduate school have provided us with the basis of success as we move on to various careers. These intangible lessons and personal growth that accrues from completing a PhD is greater than the sum of the tangible products. They form the solid foundation for us to continue to grow and excel as leaders as we move on to various stages in our careers, whether that's to a postdoc, industry, teaching, or something else entirely. While I am saddened that we cannot be together to celebrate this milestone, I treasure the sum of experiences that have made up our PhDs and believe that we can overcome whatever unexpected challenges come next. Thank you.
Thank you very much for those remarks. At this time, I have the great privilege to welcome Dr. Carolyn Smith, Dean of the Graduate School of Biomedical Sciences, who will present the candidates for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy.
Dr. Klotman, Dr. Monroe, I have the high honor and privilege of presenting to you at this time 90 candidates for the degree Doctor of Philosophy. These candidates have satisfactorily completed all of their requirements for the PhD, including a research dissertation describing new biomedical knowledge derived from their unique discoveries. I also have the high honor and privilege of presenting to you, also at this time, 11 candidates for the degree Master of Science. These candidates have satisfactorily completed all of the requirements for the degree. On behalf of the faculty of the Graduate School of Biomedical Sciences, I am pleased to recommend to you that you confer upon each of them the degree of Doctor of Philosophy or the degree of Master of Science as appropriate, and admit them to all of their rights, responsibilities, and privileges.
Upon the recommendation of the faculty and by the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees of Baylor College of Medicine, I confer upon you the degree of Doctor of Philosophy and the degree of Master of Science and admit you to all its rights, responsibilities, and privileges.
Now I would like to invite Mr. Andrew Wallace Jensen, President of the School of Medicine Class of 2020, to share remarks on behalf of tonight's medical school graduates.
Hello. It is such a blessing to be here today, celebrating the end of one chapter with the beginning of another just on the horizon. It took so much for us to get to this point, including hard work, dedication, passion, perseverance, and sacrifice. All of these attributes have carried us through the course of rigorous education, allowing us the privilege of graduating today. As we move forward from here, it is important that we maintain those very things that got us to this point. However, in light of the recent worldwide events and the complete alteration to our lives that occurred thereafter, I think there's one more additional core concept that is important to keep in mind, and that is positivity. Prior to the COVID-19 pandemic and the resulting societal impact, positivity has played an incredibly vital role in our lives as medical students, trainees, and healthcare professionals. We have created a supportive network for one another, including positive affirmations with accomplishments and nurturing remarks during times of strife. Our loved ones have helped us, loved us, and influenced us through the highs and lows of medical education. And through the entire experience, positivity has shined through, enabling us to continue in our path in conquering our goals. Recently, these actions and ways of positivity have been enhanced and in some ways creatively carried out. We've taken part in volunteering, providing donations, forming online gatherings and social media movements. And in so doing, Our world has shown how we can uplift one another and place an emphasis on support when times get tough. So this often overlooked and kind of ignored notion of positivity has played a massive role in our past and is playing a role right now in our present. And it can play a role in our future. Because a positive attitude can uplift a colleague who is struggling with the often overwhelming work that is medicine. An encouraging conversation can lift the spirits of a patient who is facing daunting courses of tests and treatments. And an upbeat attitude can inspire those earlier on in training, instilling the very aspects of medicine that make us so passionate and dedicated. In a world filled with confusion and uncertainty, being a source of positivity to uplift those around us is important, and in the world of medicine, absolutely critical. We as students are so thankful for the faculty and everyone at Baylor College of Medicine, especially the passionate work by our deans. To my colleagues, I am so honored and privileged to have trained alongside you here at Baylor. Thank you so much, and congratulations, Baylor College of Medicine, class of 2020.
We'd like to express our appreciation to Mr. Jensen and all of the student speakers. At this time, I would like to welcome Dr. Joe Cass, Associate Dean of Student Affairs, who will now administer the Physician's Pledge.
Thank you, Dr. Monroe and Dr. Clubman. So, it is my great honor to invite the 2020 graduates of the School of Medicine of Baylor College of Medicine to rise and join me in reciting the Physician's Pledge. I also invite all other physicians who are in this room or who are their graduates at home or elsewhere to stand and recite the pledge as well. As a physician, I solemnly pledge to dedicate my life to the service of humanity. The health and well-being of my patient will be my first consideration. I will respect the autonomy and dignity of my patient. I will maintain the utmost respect for human life. I will not permit considerations of age, disease or disability, creed, ethnic origin, gender, nationality, political affiliation, race, sexual orientation, social standing, or any other factor to intervene between my duty and my patient. I will respect the secrets that are confided in me even after the patient has died. I will practice my profession with conscience and dignity and in accordance with good medical practice. I will foster the honor and noble traditions of the medical profession. I will give to my teachers, colleagues, and students the respect and gratitude that is their due. I will share my medical knowledge for the benefit of the patient and the advancement of healthcare. I will attend to my own health, well-being, and abilities in order to provide care of the highest standard. I will not use my medical knowledge to violate human rights and civil liberties, even under threat. I make these promises solemnly, freely, and upon my honor.
Thank you, Dr. Cass. And now it is my high honor to introduce Dr. Jennifer Christner, the Dean of the School of Medicine, who will present the candidates for the degree of Doctor of Medicine.
Dr. Clapman and Dr. Monroe, I have the high honor and privilege of presenting to you at this time the 193 candidates for the degree Doctor of Medicine. They have satisfactorily completed all the requirements for the degree. On behalf of the faculty of the School of Medicine, I am pleased to recommend that you confer upon each candidate the degree Doctor of Medicine and admit them to all its rights, responsibilities, and privileges.
And now this is where it's not good that we're not at Jones Hall, because I like to remind people that until I actually say this, they don't get a degree. And usually that, you know, drives 700 people in the audience crazy. But it's true. I'm leaving. No, actually. Upon the recommendation of the faculty and by the authority vested in me by the Board of Trustees of the Baylor College of Medicine, I confer upon you the degree of Doctor of Medicine and admit you to all its rights, responsibilities, and privileges. Congratulations to all our graduates. Remember that in everything you do, you represent Baylor College of Medicine. I want you to go out and inspire your colleagues and everyone that you're in contact with. I know you'll continue to make us proud. I know it's virtual, but this is the end of our ceremony, and thank you so much. We look forward to seeing people in person, hopefully next year. Congratulations. Thank you.